those of you that don't know Constance, she is from Albuquerque, works and lives in Albuquerque, teaches at the University of New Mexico. And we have enjoyed doing these dialogues with the artists because it gives all of us a little bit of an understanding of sort of how they work and what their thought process is. And so without any further ado, Constance DeJong.
Further on, I was you speak
Valley? There's a whole suite of new works here that are all made from folded mylar and manipulated plastic material. I mean, that material certainly must have influenced how you manipulate it and how you handle it. And you might tell us a little something about that suite of how.
Yeah, the mylar piece.
Yeah, if these here on
yeah.
The
floor. Well, this whole, not these two, but all the rest of the work were based on 4-3 proportions. I talked earlier about numerical logic, and I'm going to answer this question, so take that. When I seem to have two distinct ways of working. One is with a very active numerical logic in which I am picking out theorems like the golden theory or the Fibonacci series or something like that. And I'm making work that has a more geometric look to it and more complicated. It starts to build on itself and it really, it's really how my work started to be really my own. And that was when I decided I didn't want to make work about anything. I wanted to parallel sort of the natural look of nature, the growth of nature, without trying to be sentimental about it, loving it, you know, without trying to make a flower or something, which I'm fine with making a flower, but at the time I didn't want to. So I understood about golden sections and proportions, and so I just started dealing with those directly. And in that first work, I would have like 10 exact rectangles, blacken them all, this is the steel, and then I would cut into them all 1 inch differently and make those folds, and then those folds would inform the next thing I did, and so on. So each unit had a 10 degree difference from the next one. And so I wouldn't ever go in and do anything because I thought it looked good. I would accept that, and I would align that in certain coordinates, and the work would grow, itself. So this work you can trace through all of my work, how that kind of thinking informed the aluminum work and the copper flat work, and certainly the copper large work. Then, the second way of working, I'm going to get to this, is actually more explicit in this group of work, and that is, we'll take the columns as an example. I was starting with working with the angle that you see in honeycombs, so I made a little thin wire in that angle. Then I had a piece of paper and I drew that angle, and then I soldered little pins onto that wire and stuck it through the paper, through another piece of metal even, and then I lit it, and then the shadow created. Another angle. So what I had on the wall were these small pieces that were, they really came out into space, they were very active, and there was, you never knew which one was which, and it was, I wanted to make them larger, so I took another along the wall, and I just slightly bent it, getting ready to make another one of those. And just that, it was just so subtle and so interesting the way it made its mark on the wall, that I just started working with just that kind of subtlety. So it really wasn't an evolved kind of geometric progression or anything like that, but it was more just about the space that I was creating with these things. And so these works are really very pulled back. They're not starting to develop these progressions just about subtle shifts and picking up light, and like those mylar pieces, if you pick one up right now and walked around the room, they'd start changing because I'm trapping light. So it's a 4-3 like these, but these are sort of aggressive in a way. They're pulling out your space, and you're seeing what's happening, the light reflecting and being absorbed and then reflecting. But with the mylar, then what's happening is that it's seeping underneath it. You're seeing how the overlay is making another shape here. It's just a different way of staying in this narrow. So that's what the majority of the work in here is, just investigating that 4-3 proportion and the meaning of those things, what's happening. I also bent these rectangles and these columns so that that became another element in it. They're not just rectangles, they're,
Yeah.
That's been from the very beginning. It's just keep, it helps to keep these things involved. It does.
But, so obviously the material is constantly teaching you, even when it's something so effectively subliminal as Mylar.
Yeah.
But what I noticed in those Mylar works is how meticulous the matting is. I mean, it had to be quite a recessed space. And yet even the matting itself is extremely well thought, extremely well thought of, because it, the bevel is inward and not outward.
Yeah.
You can kind of see the bevel and that in there very easily, but it's hidden.
Right.
In terms of side to side.
I like working with all the materials as equal things. Like those columns are not metal on paper. It's metal and paper having their own property in it. And the housings, they're more like frames on the white. And they started with the black, their little housing. And I'll make work a couple, 3 months. The housings, what they go on, 6 months. I mean, it's really critical. I have to figure those out. Then I have to, I'm not a woodworker, so I have to have those done. They'll come back, I'll look at them. They might be a quarter of an inch off or wrong. The angle might be different. So how these small scale I love small scale. Whole lot. How they live in the world is critical. They really need to be thought out. Those black things have had two whole different lives. They all framed, and then tossed out the next year. I thought, I just look at this, not right. Something dawned on me finally about bringing the space in to meet those. But it is a big thought for me, because I'm in an area that's not painted. It's not really sculpture in a way, because it's on the wall. So I'm constantly engineering these things and creating all kinds of problems for everybody. But it's also, as I think you were saying, a part of their live and die. They're either good or not good by those conditions. Yeah, if those housings aren't holding them right and shut and being a part of it, then the work is just, you know, you couldn't possibly take those and just pin them on the wall. They just,
It
doesn't work.
Still on the subject of materials, but in the book that Arden Reed did on your work, he floated the notion of a certain alchemy in your work. And we know that the alchemists in the Renaissance, their one goal was to manipulate chemicals and materials and laboratory fires and so on in order to turn frost into common matter into pure gold.
Alchemy.
Yeah, alchemy, right.
And
you are indelibly identified with copper in your work, though not exclusively, as we can see.
Yeah.
So my question is two-part. What is it about copper that attracts you again and again over the many years? And if you could substitute sheets of 18 karat gold, would that make any difference? Would you want to?
I guess I like the red glow more than a yellow glow. Mm-hmm. And I did actually, you know those little arcs of copper? I actually bought a sheet of gold. And I did one. It's okay. But you know, the copper, just, I don't know, it's just great. And it's such a giving material. Yeah. And it takes a stain really well. Now I'm just doing black. But I think, I shouldn't say just black, it's black. But I've done a lot of other colors, and copper takes other colors too. I did a series of nitrate paints and stuff. I think it and things. It doesn't, I don't have that relationship with it. It's just that it takes black really well and folds nicely.
And yes, and it has a fatal effect too.
It does if you work in patina. Yeah. My work is always a dialogue between painting and drawing and sculpture. Now, I didn't set out as an intellectual pursuit to have this happen. It's just occurs. And I noticed it early on in the work, and it continues. But these have a painterly surface.
Yeah. What is this? It's referring to the press release to poor chemistry.
Yeah.
So, I mean, can you describe that?
Yeah. Just all metals have chemicals that react with them to do certain things. Blues, greens, blacks, this kind of thing. So, I take the large pieces out. I have a rock yard that the water just goes. Just huge buckets. Oh, I have like five burners out there making the hot. I have big brushes and, you know, the sun's making it. And I have the parts that I want to be reflective sealed off so that patina won't take. And I just work for however long. Sometimes it'll take a month every day to go back out this thing. Why isn't my system go, well, I thought it looked pretty good. It will look pretty good, but it doesn't have that curl that I need. You know, there's something going on with it. And when you're just dealing with these big shapes, you better have a nice surface on me. You know, and I do, because I love precision, and I love, these things are like really right there, I want my surface to be more forgiving, more organic, more soulful, to counter that, to work so that I like to see the flow, the natural flow of these. They're tilted up so that it draws down some of the patina and it gets to the sides, which I think is fine. I think that if these were painted flat, these would just have no soul.
Lifeless.
I have something that I would like.
What does it feel like in the painting process? What does it feel like being immersed in this?
In the painting process?
In the painting process, boring. I mean, because apparently your characters can stand those I've seen somewhere. I mean, it must be almost kind of zen-like experience.
Well, it could be, but no. Not any more than I think any other process is where you just give it all. Yeah, I don't have a real attachment to the process necessarily. I mean, I do love seeing it happen. To me, it's just like work. I just want it to get right, and it's just.
And you want to reach a certain patina.
It has to build up in a really good way. And I also have to calculate that because I know it's going to be sealed. I have to be able to identify a surface and know that once it's sealed, because it's going to change, that's a surface I'm going to like. Mm-hmm. So that's taken a lot of these things, a lot of them are thrown away. Yeah. Because all of a sudden it'll get surfaced. And that's a whole other thing, getting a clear coat without a thingy in it. These are just anyway. No, but I love doing them. I have to see them large, and these work. You know, I only lose a few things to clear coating, but you do, but they're gone.
Well, you said way back in something I read that you never want an idea to assert itself in your work.
Well, a design or a design idea.
You want to be very sure that there is something beyond simply the assertion of an idea.
Absolutely. I do teach at university, but my feeling is the best response to an artwork is, ooh, we're all, you know, sort of unintelligible and not intellectual, just, oh. You know, to me that's the response that I would like. Or ooh, you know, so someone said once, it's so huge, it makes you want to live, or so tiny, it makes you want to die, or it's the opposite. I just like the really large, getting lost in the work, or so tiny that it's so intimate that you're drawn in. I don't think I have a really, really tiny work here today. I'm looking at one way up there. I just love going between scales, and I think every You can do it at any scale. But these, I do have little ones like of those, but I feel like they're completely different works. But those, at any other scale besides those, don't work. You would think, well, I could have some that were mid-sized for people to actually put them in their houses, like I made to sell a few. Right? Why wouldn't I be doing something like this? Because it would be so good. I don't think they work. I think they have to be like that, or they have to be like that. It's just me. And they can't be any smaller than that. Scale's a big deal for me, how things live or die.
Well, that's one of the unifying principles, because there are three different kinds. There are distinctly different bodies of work this time in this exhibition.
Yeah.
So that is one of the underlying principles of unifying the body. Do you have any other observations on how they all hang together in this installation?
In some ways, I curated this show. In the past, it was always what I had done in that year. And it's always, of course, thematically tight, because it's what I had done that year. I really, really wanted these pieces that had never been seen, these large 4x3s, to come into this fantastic space. Mm-hmm. And they're not recent, but they haven't been shown here. And so I brought them out. And I realized how the pieces that I had done that were called rods a while back looked like what was going on in the inside of these pieces. And in fact, those came next from those pieces a while back. So I reinvented those rods into the broken columns, or just called columns. But they are in fact a 4-3 proportion like those. And I put those back out. Yeah. And made housings, and then the mylar things came about. I had made about 15 drawings at one time using mylar. I looked at all of them, and I completely deconstructed all of them, and got three coming to it a whole different way that I thought were really interesting and started to inform those again. So in this case, in this show, I'm really utilizing things that I had been working on previously and then reconstituting certain ones and or just showing those to pure show.
So this does inform them, I mean.
Yeah.
They're informed in different bodies of work. Somewhere in the press release of the 4-3 series here, the works are described as darkly infested.
Yeah.
Wow, big. Can you translate that for us?
No, I have no idea what you mean. But I think they are big brooding things, and you know, I like music that's sad and movies that are funny. You know, I just like art that has a somber quality to it. I do. I like Rothko. I think Rothko's in my work in some way. I don't like art that's funny, that has a sense. I mean, it's okay, but it's not that
wrong.
No, it's not for me. So I can imagine why these seem moving to people, because I think they probably are. And also, not so much in this group as it's showing, but in a lot of this big brooding work, there's that raw copper that then is really...
Well, you know, in those white drawings, which I think are really towards the force of...
The Mylar white drawings.
Mylar drawings, as they're calling them.
You like those?
Oh, all of those, okay. Yeah. But the thing is, they're towards the force of the most delicate subliminal or something. I mean, they really have to get in there and see all the niceties. And they remind me, with great pleasure, of the work of, say, Robert Ryman.
Oh, Ryman, yeah. I like Ryman. He comes to my work kind of after.
After the fact.
Yeah, and I do like it a lot.
Yeah.
I've always, when I think about these guys, I do think my work is more feminine. I mean, I guess yes, I would be. But there is a lightness in mine. There's more delicacy in my work. There's more sensuality in my work. And I think Hickey wrote on the back of that book, something to that, to that
effect,
that these, you know, have that edge to them. That's my contribution. Because I am within an obvious.
You have a particular artistic ancestry.
Yeah, happily, and everyone does. In this work, and so when I look at their work, like there is a sensuality in my work that is not in their work. Mm-hmm. I think how it differentiates, I think, mostly.
Although I think these monologue drawings are quite sensual.
Yeah, I think all my work is. I mean,
you can feel nature definitive switch.
Oh, good.
You know how that must have felt to folding that.
Yeah.
Fascinating.
Well, the little pins I make, they're sterling silver.
Is that one that has that?
Yeah.
Because I mean, they're practically.
Well, you can't, if you put anything in these, because they're so not there, but I'm not gluing. That's the other thing. I'm a mechanical engineer. I don't believe in gluing or doing anything that's not. I'm like Frank Lloyd Wright, truth to materials. If two things need to be attached, you do it the way the metals, why you do it. You don't use super glue. So in a collage you use glue because paper wants to be glued, but my stuff doesn't. I'm a metal worker, and so I figure out the metal fastenings. So with these, because they are so light, I couldn't use my brass pins that I make. I heat the end till it balls up. I use number 80, finest wire. All my drill bits I have from 80 to 1. I have every drill bit ever made. They're like this thin. The drill bits, and you have to figure out how to, this is what I do. So I had to get silver because that would disappear, right? So I just made the same thing and then pinned it. So that's how those are built, the silver pins.
Terrific. Yeah. Well, let's change course. If you want to sell these, let's say if you want to sell these in the end of the world, sort of a great encyclopedic art museum, white and blue, but Constance DeJong Museum, all the metropolitan museum bar.
What?
And you have an hour.
Okay.
I'd be very curious what you would make a beeline for.
See, now I like the way that question is posed. Because a lot of people say to artists, who influenced you? And who wants to say that? But it's like, what art would you rush to in a museum if there was every single work? I like that's a good way of talking about that.
All right, let's say
that. Well, I always go to see what a Vermeer. Now, we've only did like 30 paintings.
Is
he great?
Yeah.
I mean, can I see Vermeer? How about the milk? It's that delicacy that I was, when you think his work, how can I relate to it? But it is so, I just like the sense of
it.
In a Vermeer.
Very sensual, his work.
Yeah,
so one tends to always talk about the lot of reasons, aren't
Yeah, yeah.
But they're very sensual.
Yeah. And he's Dutch. But then I go to the guys that you would expect. I always like to see a Rothko. Ryman I wouldn't run to necessarily. I like his work, but I think it doesn't speak to me as much as what you would think.
No, I'm thinking about with your ancestors through his.
Well, he's definitely right there in terms of materials. I like the way he works.
Oh, yeah.
That would be the exchange. Somebody like, oh, Reinhardt. Ed Reinhardt, please. Yeah, I'd like to see Ed Reinhardt.
Sure.
And Degas. I like Degas. I think he's good. It's beautiful. I like beautiful work.
Well, I guess also it's all about the materials, the balances and counterbalances.
Yeah. Yes.
Levels. Charlotte has been a champion for many years, but not a very important Charlotte Jackson's gallery has championed over the decades another important abstraction in New Mexico, Florence Theater.
Florence, yes.
Yeah, I mean, I just wonder if you think that there's any kinship or affinity between you at all. I mean, because somehow I sense, particularly these new Mylar drawings, have something about
transparency
and
was doing these pieces. And so I don't think we necessarily had a, I think we were working separately. I love her, but I think we were both quite developed on our own before we knew that much about each other. That's what I think about.
But you're both committed to it, to totally non-objective paths, that's for sure.
Oh, yeah.
And a certain transcendence.
Yeah, I'm old-fashioned about that. I think art can transport you to...
Because the goal and meaning you can look at is something quite transcendental. I
mean, yeah.
So, I mean, the Gallery's press release said that there were two bodies of work that shift between alternative states of mind or states of the soul. I think that's I was reminded that poetry, the poems of Milton, there are two poems he wrote, one about all things were meaning and doctrine, called Compensarosa, and then the flanking poem is called Allegro.
I have both those, don't I?
Yeah, you do. Yeah. Gravitate between
in one word.
What's the dynamic of those pieces once again in one to be perhaps robots? I mean, what is the
columns over there?
The columns,
right? You want to know how those came about?
Yeah.
Well, I think I should just talk about the rods first, because as I was saying, you know, I made those little loops first, and then I started to bend the rod, it was enough. But at that time, you know, I was doing a lot of non-thinking, sitting at the Zen Center, doing this, doing that, and trying to, just get rid of the thoughts. I think what happened with me, particularly after a real session, is that I just didn't take much to, I couldn't watch TV or anything. It's like, whoa, you know. I love TV, so I'm not saying anything bad about it. But at that time, it just didn't take much at all to. And that's, I think, how I arrived at those works. So. And these, simply, I just wanted to cut them and do a 4-3 thing and work just a little bit more with understanding what I was up to. I didn't finish them. You know, I did a few of them and I left them and I started doing something else. So I just wanted to come back to those.
Well, maybe we could open up for questions. But anybody have any queries?
I was just going to make a comment about this about Florence Pierce, and that is that the first time I ever went to Florence Pierce's studio, I looked up and there was there were pieces, and I did the work and I said to Florence, "Well, which work is that?" It's one of the red ones.
Yeah.
And she said, "Oh, that's Constance DeJong. So that's really a great piece." And it always lived on the wall. There was that piece on the wall, and there was a picture of Agnes Varda on the wall. I have a question. Well, sort of a question and comment. When you were talking about how you like things to be precise, and you also like things to be painterly, and how these things, you know, interact. And then you said that you love Degas, and I think about, you know, the famous quote that, and where somebody said to Degas, "Draw along its own man," blah, blah, blah. When I look at these pieces, I'm not seeing straight lines, I'm seeing very varied line of copper. And in the Mylar pieces, there are these random little marks. I mean, I looked really closely, and I saw that one of the cuts had like a little bit of graphite on the edge of it. So things are not pristine. They're precise, but they're not pristine.
That's right.
And I figure that you probably did that on purpose. And I mean, you could have sort of taped everything off and had like a really hard edge line, and you don't.
Yeah, I don't. You know, I really like the Parthenon, or is it the Pantheon? Which one? No, Pantheon. So does Adlmann. He's got a
round.
The round one. You know, I like a lot of architecture, and it has to be very precise. It's going to fall down. But I really like the patina on those buildings, and I like things that happen in time to them. And you you know, maybe that's part of it. It's just, it's instinctual for me to let things, to get their structure really resolved and really solid, and then just let the rest kind of live. Now, having said that, I'm fanatical about my surfaces. Once the process has, I've let it live, boy, don't get near it. you're gonna go and, because I don't want accidents to happen after the fact. I don't want move marks. I don't want scratches. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the process where gravity is a part of it, or light is a heat is a part of it. This I want to have it expressed in the work, and then it's sealed and stopped and don't screw it.
How can you see the leaves? I mean,
well, clear coat. It's the worst. The small ones, you just do a little spray can, lovely, nice matte. Well, for instance, I mean, I would buy every single clear coat that exists, and I would make cover things from the same number and do tests. I mean, I've got like notes. I'm like a little scientist. I mean, oh, that affected it this way. Oh, that's too glossy. Oh, that's nice and matte, but it kills all the nuance. Oh, this does that. And then I find the right one, and for a long time it was great. And then they changed the formula because of VOCs, which they had to because of the environment nonetheless.
Yeah.
Back to the drawing board, and then trying to get a big surface even. I have to become a car painter oversight, you know? That's hard.
Yeah, because these have to be.
The rest is easy.
Just all these greens, and it was super painterly in the more traditional sense of painterly.
Yeah.
And sort of what was the transition between coming from those colors, which were really sort of bright, to this darker, this where it's almost, and I totally see it, where it's still very painterly and very moody, but it's a completely different aesthetic.
Well, those are very gestural, the ones with the green, with the different green. Mm-hmm. You can see all the movements of their application, whereas this, you tend to just see an incrustation.
Yeah, I like to see, you know, and I like seeing that green and for a while, but my real tendency is if we just start getting more dark naturally, I would be happier. Mm-hmm. It's just something about me that I just, I guess I'm not in the show, in the back room. There's the backs of some of these. Some of the backs of these are just wonderful because they're just red and blue stripes. Things that happen when this is like liver of silver. When it first hits a surface of copper, you get magenta, you get blue, you get orange, you get all these colors first hit. And so sometimes on the backs, they'll just be areas of first hit. But then there'll be areas of second and third. And there could be a work I can do at some point where I might, you know, really exploit that. But there's just something about my nature that wants to keep going and start to deny that, hold it back, and just have the copper edge. It's a sensual. It's more about that again. It's denying a lot of things and just having a little part of it come at you. It's seductive, maybe more seductive. You know,
so when you work on a piece of copper versus a tiny fastener, do you experience the copper as a series of precise events or as creation on a grander scale?
When I'm working smaller, do I see them just as...
Well, you work on a big sheet of copper. Does it feel like there's a whole lot of little precise things happening, or is it just you and the copper in a big sheet?
It's mainly the second. It's just me and the big sheet of copper. I notice a whole lot of things. But it's a completely different. It's like two sides of me. And then when I'm sitting in the studio, you know, working on these little things and getting precise, boy, everything it counts, and I'm measuring this, and I mean, you know, and it's a different kind of feeling. I really love it. But then some things just need to be big. And then when they get big, I have to kind of just let go of all the detail stuff and just start working big and watching what happens. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just. It is a different quality that comes to that work. Yeah.
Constance, have you ever thought of suspending them where you could display both sides?
No. I mean, I might have thought of it for a minute, but then I wouldn't do that because I really want to make a decision. I want to say this is what is represented here. I don't want to give the people the opportunity to decide what they like best in my work. Well, I'm going to contradict myself right now. When there's a lot of my works, all these small works, when you carry them around, they're all have copper, they change completely. So that when someone purchases one of these, it may look a certain way, and unless they want to duplicate the light, which isn't really hard to do, they're going to get a different piece when they get home. So they're going to walk around with a piece until they find the piece they like, and then they hang it right there and they light it because it changes so radically with that. But that's built into those pieces. I know that happens not. The backs of these are...
Backstage?
Yeah. Now, I do have works. There's three little small pieces here that I've reversed it. But that's after seeing about 50 or 60 of the backs and denying all of the backs as interesting pieces. I'm not going to go in and mess with any of them. I don't believe in designing in that sense. But if something happens, it's great. I mean, it's sort of like it's like Frankenthal and those guys. They'll do a whole bunch of stuff and then they'll come in and they'll find an area that they think is working in those four paintings. And that's their work. So that's kind of what I'm doing with these, although I don't cut and edit like they do. I don't crop. But I will pick 3 out of 50 that I think, oh gosh, that's nice. There's an interesting structure going on. I like the way the color's working. I like the reflective quality. This is like a little tiny painting that happened. And I go, great. And then I'll put it next to something else to make it work even more in a more interesting way.
Okay.
I'm sure we appreciate the way you curate this, yeah.
I just have one comment, sort of question. These two groups of work seem very different.
Yeah.
There's almost a sort of, there's a kind of fragmented, serene, almost playful quality about these compared to these pieces, which are very grand and very intense.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. I consider the theme of this show within here, and these are tangential pieces that I thought had a nice resonance with it, but they are. They're in a different kind of mode. We talked about that earlier and decided to really focus on more of the theme that I was working on when this show was being originated and grown. But there's absolute relationships, but they're very different. And I can see why they are more playful. And I even at one time entitled them with that person.
Yeah.
That was more playful. So you totally, I completely agree with that.
This is a great example of how it's written. But how you can take the same